I'm Tangren Alexander, or Jean Tangren Alexander, and I taught at SOU kind of off and on and in various ways from 1974 until 2006. So I guess I'll just take your questions in order. Like a good student, I made a lot of notes. What the campus was like when I started. So we're talking 1974. John, my husband at the time, we had both gone to graduate school together, and he had gotten a job in San Fernando State, and we had lived there for a couple of years and were just delighted when suddenly they need a professor back here. And Art Kreisman, our families knew each other a little bit from Unitarians, actually. And we had told him after a year down in the LA area that you know, we'd be happy and please let us know if a job ever opened up. And so yeah, I think it was September when the person suddenly left or died, or I've forgotten what it was, but anyway, suddenly they needed a philosophy professor, so John took the job. And I'd sort of been on the mommy track. I almost got my PhD and had a child, so a daughter. She was 4 when we moved to Ashland then, that would be right. And we first lived elsewhere, but we moved into that house next door to Beverly and Betty Lou. So what was the campus like? So my first job, actually, at the time there had been a philosophy department of 1.5 people, and John took the one job, and the other half was taught by a nun, actually, who for some reason was teaching there, and she left after a couple of years, and we pointed out that I also had a philosophy degree, and I was working on my PhD at the time. I'd done everything but the dissertation. So I took this half-time job, and I can remember how nervous I was. I thought, they'll know I'm not a teacher, you know, but it did all work. I remember I stood up there and smoked cigarette after cigarette, which at the time was, you know, it was allowed in classes. It was something people did, but it got me through my first thing. And at first, I kind of did just an imitation of what my philosophy teachers had done, yeah. And after a couple of years, I thought there's got to be something better than this. And especially in teaching ethics, there were beginning to be this movement of teaching relevant ethics instead of what is the meaning of the word good and stuff like that. That was starting to happen in philosophy department, so I thought I could probably get away with it. But plus, we had this incredible freedom because the department was just John and me. There was not anybody else. So it's like if it was okay with John and it was okay with me, there was like nobody else like really overseeing us. And it gave me really a wonderful freedom to invent courses and ways of doing courses and subject matter and things like that. So after a while, you know, when John and I started out, it was just the late 60s, and it was just kind of the end of this time when education had been growing and growing, and we thought, well, we'll probably end up as like in a department of four people or something like that. You know, we'll build a department. And instead of that, our whole time we were fighting not to disappear. And what the university got for splitting one job to two people is, of course, they got two people that worked almost full time, you know, and so they got a lot of good work for that. And we actually didn't always go 50-50. I took time off to build this house and do some other building projects for one, and I took 2 years off at different times to try to work on a historical novel about Queen Christina that I was working on. But it was really nice that way. They were kind of open to that, to just being flexible. We had seen before that, we had some friends, the Onks, who were faculty members here, and they got hit with a nepotism charge when they were both teaching here. And, you know, they just really wouldn't give her a job because they thought it would be nepotism. And, you know, there just wasn't, things have changed 180 degrees, I think, nowadays, hopefully. But anyway, we felt lucky that the school was as open as they were to doing that. At Helen's job, the half-time job that I took over after a couple of years disappeared. And so we asked Dr. Kreisman, who was the head of humanities at the time, if we could do two if we could split one job. And they were kind of open to it. John, they said they didn't want to give two tenures for one job, so like John kept a tenure. And I sort of said to him, well, fine, you do the committees and interface with the bureaucracy, and I'll teach half the load, and I'll be happy with that. So anyway, it did leave me free to experiment, and I soon started working with ways to give my students more voice. And I know the first year, John and I went to a party, I think it was at Lawson and Nauta's, and somebody there said, oh, I learned so much from my students. And John and I both kind of went, you do? It's like we had no concept of that from our own experience as students, that was what, you know, you could do. But you know, I learned from my students for the rest of my career by finding ways to empower them. But it was an exhausting way to teach. I have written an article about what I did with my ethics classes. The one in the Teaching Philosophy Journal that I wrote back in the 80s. And I'm about to put it up online. That's one of the things that's just about, that is ready, really. I actually ended up, for one, adopting the technique of sitting in a circle, and from what things that I'd seen in the women's community and how they worked on issues and all, was a matter of passing something around a circle, and when it came to you, it was like your turn to address whatever issue that was within the realm from your point of view. And what I liked about it is it didn't have to fit on to what the last person said. You know, it's like coming at it from whatever you would like to most take your time with. We ended up passing around an orange, and what you would most like to take your time to say. And usually, oftentimes it was people telling stories from their lives or things like that. And ethics went from using a textbook and some of these questions that I never really could get behind that were more theoretical in ethics. And I had people in the school who thought, you know, Aristotle and Kant were it. And so I was fighting all the time being dismissed because I refused to do that. And what we did was we had a different topic every day of ethical questions. We often start with animal rights, for instance, and then focus on, I don't know, violence in the society. Oh, the other thing I did to try to give my students voice is that in the writing department, in reading and writing, I gave them a choice about what to read. So I had this complicated, like, bibliography, and they had to go to the library and actually read 10 pages of something there and write something about that, as well as about the topic of the day, whatever it is. They had to write 3 pages altogether. And my philosophy, which comes a lot from being a writer myself and from going to my writer's group, is that people get better by writing more. They become better writers by writing. And whatever I could do to facilitate that. So, like, they could write a paragraph on one thing and, another paragraph on something completely different was fine with me. And I told them not to do stuff like, tell me what you're going to tell me, and then tell me it, and then tell me what you told me. And I tried to get them to forget a lot of the stuff that they were taught in their other writing classes and to just write. Which resulted in a humongous amount of reading for me. So I ended up, between that and these complicated reading lists, it was like in the 80s, you remember, I don't know if you remember, but there were like, people were compiling sets of readings for the students to read, and at first it was rather lax legally, and then it got tighter and tighter about that. But so out of my own money, I hired an assistant to do that for me, to send for all these permissions and work all that out, and to help me read with this stack of readings. So she read about half of it. And even with that, the way I taught was so kind of monofocused, just focused on teaching and doing that well. And I really ended up not having much of a life outside of teaching in many ways, except for writer's group and occasional forays when I was teaching, but that I would take periods off and focus on other stuff. But then John and I ended up splitting up. This would be like 1976 or so, when I actually moved out and pursued my own life. And at that time, we were just beginning this kind of splitting the job, and John asked Christman if it would make any difference if we were divorced. And at first he said, oh yeah, then it wouldn't work. But it turned out that we kind of convinced him that, it was an amicable split, and, we could easily get along, in the career department. So he changed his mind and let us do it. So And we each got paid, like, according to our rank. You know, John got more than I did. And John became a full professor, which it took me to the end of my career to do. But I've got to admit, my career was more spotty than John's. John kind of plugged away at it. When I came on board in 1974, and in those later years of the 70s, there was really, it was a dangerous time to be a lesbian. And, you know, those women that we talked about who are, didn't want to come out in the 70s that I tried to talk to, you know, had very good reasons for that. It was, you know, you were not safe in your job. And I do remember once going to a lecture where Art Kreisman, sort of out of nowhere, felt free to say that he was against gay rights or homosexual rights. And he said something like, you can stick it in a knothole if you want, but that doesn't make it right. And just completely intolerant kind of thing. And, you know, these were the people in power at the time. And the patriarchy was in full bloom as well. And so what I did for a long time was just lay low. And since I sort of had this umbrella of having my ex-husband interface with all that, I really didn't want them to know me. And it was a lot that I was a lesbian, but there were other things too. I just didn't think very much like they did, and wasn't necessarily in the same culture in lots of ways. So it became better as the years went on, and as women's studies became more real, and we began to have a women's studies program cobbled together of one kind and another. And then there was kind of a heyday, I guess it was in the early 80s. I mean, looking back on it, it was a heyday. We just thought it was the beginning of whatever, but it was like we had Women's History Month. Every month we celebrated all month long. There were like cultural events happening in Ashland and around in the valley, all kinds of things. And my writers group would do readings for it, and, you know, the Women's Center would feature women artists, and, well, just all kinds of, and the Women's Center was functioning really wonderfully. And Gwen Morris ran it for a while, who, you know, she's Craig Morris's wife. And actually, she's about my best friend, certainly one of my very best friends now. So there was a lot of, and there was this, what was it called, Returning Homemaker or something like that program. And just a lot of women energy going on. And during that time, I started first one course, and then it became too big for one course and split into two. So in the end, it was a one on women and philosophy, or feminism and philosophy. And that was one of the ones where I completely put together my own set of readings for it, because I came from my books that I had, and looking at things like language and how language shapes our patriarchal perceptions and things. Well, anyway, and then it sort of gave birth to another course called Women and Ethics, where I used actually a lot of literary readings, but on a whole bunch of different ethical topics again. And, you know, I had all kinds of women writing, and it was a wonderful course, and it was a wonderful collection of readings. And And I would do the same thing. The way I would do these kinds of classes was we would do the reading, and then, say if it was an hour and a half class, I would talk for about 20 minutes, and I'd try to like bring up some issues and talk about some things that have occurred to me in thinking about the readings or autobiographical stuff. And then I hand the orange around and people can just reflect from whatever they want to, again, either on the topic or on the readings. But the readings were really evocative, and so we did get a lot of interest.
You said that the 70s were a dangerous time. What did you mean by that?
Well, when your boss feels completely free to make such a comment, for a few years, I taught the topic of homosexuality without coming out. I just, that did not feel safe enough. And I, in particular, remember one time when in a smaller circle, this male student kind of confronted me about, well, what did I think about lesbian teachers or something in this way, like, I know your secret, you know, I just in a very threatening kind of way. And, you know, I did not want to lose my job. It was my way to live the life that I wanted to live. And I wanted to be taken somewhat seriously enough to be free to do what I was doing as a teacher. And
do you think Art Kreitzman's comment and the student's comment was part of a larger
society? Certainly. Oh, certainly. I mean, this,
we'd moved past it by then.
That was like the time of Anita Bryant, you know. That was just really, I mean, we're still in it, but, you know, this backlash that comes from people challenging these gender norms that in various kinds of ways that are just so ingrained as part of who people are or think they are.
So how did the Women's Center help some of this, or how did that get started? What role did it play?
I knew it best when my friend Gwen was running it, which she did for several years.
But that must have been a light.
It was. It was a place of refuge for a lot of women. And what Gwen, I know, did in particular, she connected people up. Women would come in, you know, who were feeling kind of lost on campus, and especially older women and returning women students. And there was a whole movement where women were going back to college. And so she knew all kinds of ways to connect them up with what they needed to connect up with there. And there was just so much positive women energy. There were also things like, for a while, I think it was the Women's Center, maybe it was Women's Studies, sponsored these things called noon lectures, where brown bag things, you'd go people would eat lunch and somebody from Women's Studies would give a presentation about something. I know I read a bit from the novel I was working on Queen Christina for a while. So there was all this kind of really good women energy that was happening in the late 70s and early 80s. So that helped me, you know, kind of steady me. And when I gradually got more involved with women's studies, it was not easy to get on the board at first. And it was like one from each discipline, like one from humanities, and they already had that slot. But I convinced them to change it around, because the women just really needed a support group of some kind at SOU. And there was also something in the fall that happened for several years that was some kind of get together, and they would have speakers. And I know I showed my Celine slide story there once, but they had all kinds of interesting and sometimes kind of famous women come and talk, and the women faculty would get together for that. So there was some good stuff that would happen. I was really disappointed, especially at first, at how little kind of sisterhood and support there was compared to what I was used to in the women's community that I was also a part of. But they helped me out in some tight spots, like when John retired in 1990, I think. He took early retirement, and then the question came up, what was going to happen to me, because I had been faithfully teaching there and refining my skills and working so hard to prove that I was really a good teacher. And it turned out nobody had been watching all this time, I guess. And it was, at first, the guys that were in charge were just saying, well, we're just going to open it up to a national competition and may the best person win. And I don't know, it felt to me like I'd been working all those years for something, that I was hoping to inherit John's position. Anyway, finally the Women's Studies Council got on, wrote a letter about this. And you know what happens when you get on the mommy track, and it's the husband who gets the main job and the wife who follows with whatever. And so I was what saved me in the end, it looked like I was going down, and I didn't know what I would do, because I was not going to move away from here. I'm so rooted in this community between my family and my women's community friends and my other friends, that I would rather find some other line of work, but I didn't know what I would do. And I really wanted to go on teaching. And finally, Sarah Hopkins Powell was the provost at the time. And she kind of intervened and said, wait, what's going on? You know, this woman deserves some hearing about this. And so in the end, I did get it and ended up getting the full-time job, which I then did from 93. It took them a long time to decide. But from 93 to 2003, I taught full-time. But then when it came to tenure, it was the same problem. And partly it was that my work had been kind of hidden. There were aspects of my work I didn't want the school to know about, especially in the earlier days. And just as the community was kind of hidden, the women's community, the Landite community, and it gave a kind of freedom, because people didn't know about us and people dismissed us when they did. So it's something that seems to me people have less and less these days, as that kind of privacy that comes from kind of being anonymous. Well, anyway, Sarah Hopkins Powell stepped in and got me the full-time job, got me on a tenure track, which then there are all those decisions, and I ended up near the very end of my career. I thought, well, I've really got enough to apply for full professor. I'd made it up the various steps by then. And I applied, and I came out with more of what I had published, but I guess it got dismissed or whatever. The committee decided it wasn't up to snuff for me to get tenure, and it was unanimous, which I was really surprised at. You know, I think it was because it was in a lot of women's publications and it was women focused, and you know, it wasn't in very many juried journals and that kind of thing. So anyway, at the very end, I just decided I'd had it. I had been working so hard all my life for this, and I was close to retirement, and my accountant said, look, you really can retire right now. And so I put in my 3-year request, I think, at that point. Well, I started going on the 1/3 time at that point. But then at the last minute, your husband, actually, who was my boss at the time, stepped in and said that I should get full professor at that point. But since I was retiring anyway, I didn't actually ever get paid as a full professor, but at least I got the shining honor of turning into a full professor. But so, I don't know. It's been a rocky road, but I'm also really grateful for the freedom that I had to do it my way and to teach in my way. And I've got to say, I was thinking about how many of my dearest friends first began as students, and they're just like, there's quite a few I can name who I still know and love and am in touch with, and that's another good thing about being rooted in one place, is that, you know, those students who stick around anyway, and even some of the ones who don't, we stay in touch with each other. And because actually in my classes, there's a way in which people start really to care about each other, because they heard each other's stories and each other's perspectives on ethical questions or whatever it was. I was thinking about when I first started teaching women's studies, and I was in one of those rooms in science that's kind of built sideways, and you know, it's got a desk with a fountain and sink in it, and two doors in the back, and we started in with on something with Adrian Rich, I think, and I just found it felt so uncomfortable. It was a circle of all women. I think there were like 8 or 10 of them that were there. And so what we finally did was close the doors, and it just felt like that's something we just had to do, to really close the doors to talk about what we wanted to talk about. And I know that first day was so empowering. This one woman said she went home and told her boyfriend that they needed to have a different arrangement, and then went to her job and told her boss that she needed a raise. So, a lot of the stuff was kind of life-changing, and, you know, and people, of course, bonded over just talking, and in ethics, too, in just general ethics, talking over such deep stuff. But one of the things I should say is that because we were just a one-job department divided by two people, we were so little that we had no leverage. We got the absolutely worst classrooms always. We were always fighting for our life, And the way that we learned to survive was to teach huge classes, because there was this way that it was figured what the worth of your classes were to the school that had something to do with how many students you had. And so I taught classes of between 50 and 65 at the introductory level. And every one of those people is generating 3 pages a day. But one of the things that did is, instead of one large circle, we'd often do, you know, break up into a bunch of small circles. Then I'd bring a bunch of oranges and we'd pass them around. And I've got to say, I was thinking about how students had changed. I found it harder and harder to convince the males who wanted to dominate the conversation that this orange was a good idea. But that's the thing about the orange, is that everybody gets a turn, and it gives a voice to, like, women who are not as used to being able to speak up in class and be heard. But other people, too, that just have different perspectives than you'd expect. And I think one thing we always learned was not to judge people by how they look or your first impressions of them or even, you know, further impressions, because people would keep surprising you about what experiences they'd had or what they'd been through. And that was a wonderful ethics lesson to learn, I think. I want to say, when I did finally get the job full time, that Betty LaDuc was the one person who a bit acted like a mentor. I mean, we didn't have such a thing as mentors in those days, and especially when I was sort of in hiding, I didn't. But she took me out to dinner after it happened, and the one bit of advice she gave me that I'll always remember is, don't let the committees sink you down to the point where you lose track of your artistic whatever you're doing. And sometimes they did anyway. When I was doing my part to be on committees, they were the very hardest part of the job, I think. Okay, what were the students like? I loved the students at SOU. Not all of them, but I think I learned to teach in a way that took advantage of who the students were and what they brought to the situation. And what was wonderful was that was the older students, was the returning students, was the Vietnam vets who just had a perspective that the younger people really needed to hear. And the nursing students I used to just love, I think a lot because they were older women. And in general, the older students were trying harder and more serious about life. And I refused to take part in anything like these things that teach everybody when they're 19 or when they first came in. I wouldn't know how to draw wisdom from 19-year-olds. I'm not sure in some ways that it's there. They're full of opinions, a lot of, but, oh, I shouldn't generalize. But the older students were just a treasure. And the conversation between ages was really good. And, you know, they're not going to listen to me for an hour, but they do listen to each other in a way that I think they just learned a lot from, both from listening and speaking. And I would tell them they were graded on listening as well as speaking, so that listening was just as important. And so, anyway, we all learned a lot and really had quite a bit of fun in that. There were sometimes some really challenging males who were really challenged by just a woman having power in the class and then, you know, touching on that. And they could make a class really hard and make it hard for us to do among ourselves what we want to do. I mean, there were females too, but it was mostly males. And And I don't know, that was hard all through my career. But at the same time, I often did find a way to rise to the challenge that kind of surprised me and, you know, made it so we could go on, or I would end up making friends with them. Or, like, I remember one student who was hard, who years later I ran into, he was jogging down here on the road, and he stopped and he asked me what I'd meant by something or other I'd said, and I have no idea what it was. But he said, you know, after your class, I really changed, and he wanted to tell me that he'd really changed. And, you know, so you don't always know what you do with people. You just sow your seeds where you can. How did you counter these attitudes personally, socially, academically, politically? I was out as a lesbian to my students for more than a decade before I was out to the faculty and the administration. We sort of had this pact that what happened in the class stayed in the class, and I don't know if it did or not, but anyway, nothing official was said. But then, of course, I couldn't talk about what I was doing publishing-wise or any kind of thing. And I certainly couldn't talk about my social life and what such as it was. And at first, I hope I'm not repeating myself about this, but I felt really like I had a double life, like the three faces of Eve kind of thing, where actually, like, this person didn't know things that this person knew, and sometimes vice versa, because being a college professor and sort of suiting up for that and going in and doing that and taking that power in that group of people, but only taking a part of myself there, because there were things I couldn't talk about or truths I knew I couldn't say. And that was hard to transit back and forth, especially like at the beginning of the year after I'd had a summer off or something. And I would just, like, the lesbian culture, the land women's culture, really is so different in terms of the social rules and everything. It's just such a, it's so much better in some ways, so much freer. But, you know, then I'd go back into that other one and think to the school culture and, like, be afraid I'd commit some gaffe or say something that didn't make sense or couldn't in their context or whatever. So it was kind of silencing. But that's the thing is, as gay rights began to surface and against all odds actually got a hearing and actually became the law of the land in some ways after many decades of struggles around that, it became more, I became more able to integrate my two worlds. I became more able to speak about it in the SOU world and to bring some of more and more of what I knew from this world into this world. And that helped a lot, I think, to heal that kind of split that I felt for so many years. So maybe that takes us to how and whence did you find solace? So I would say friends. I would say the writers group, my writers group above all, that's like the most central community I have, the Southern Oregon Women Writers Group. That's been going since 1980 and been an institution sort of based on land dikes in the area, but open to other women as well. So, and just the understanding of feminism that I got from them, and some from books, more from the culture, really. So that was part of it. Then a large part of it was journaling. I kept journals. I did that a lot. I would sit down and just write about what my dreams were, or what was going on, or how teaching was going, or various kinds of stuff like that. So those, that whole set of journals there are what I generated during that time. Just kind of as a way to have my thoughts to myself, to be able to be all the parts of me that existed. And I've got to say, the third factor was probably marijuana. I was using marijuana all that time as a source of self-knowledge and as a source of confidence for doing my classes and doing them imaginatively. So it really did get, I credit it for getting me through a lot. But again, that was a personality that I, a part of myself that I couldn't manifest in the SOU context by any means. So that's been, there's been progress on that front too. And for me, the biggest thing about legalization of marijuana is freedom of speech that I have now that I did not have for all those years.
Can I ask a question? You talk about the land women.
The land women?
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And the land dykes? Did you go to those communities during the summer?
No, I didn't live there ever.
How did I?
It was mainly connected through groups that I, there was the Southern Oregon Women's Writers Group, which went on for a long time and met every 3 weeks for, since 1981. And meets anywhere from Ashland to Roseburg. So in little cabins off the road oftentimes and things. So there was that. There was the writing group. But then at one time, especially, we really flourished when T. Corinne was here. She was an artist, photographer, writer, that was super productive and very interested in getting our culture out to a larger audience. It wasn't that. It was also, there was a painter's group and a photographer's group that also met. T was part of those as well. So there were just, and you know, there were women putting on plays. Carolyn Gage was here for a while and doing No to Men theater, and you know, the land dykes would occasionally come down here and do presentations. There was like women artists, musicians coming through all the time, concerts, you know, with people that we love to hear. And so there was just a culture for a while, as well as the academic culture that knew about stuff like women's history. And like, I worked hard to incorporate women into all my classes, which was not easy considering the available literature and like history of philosophy. I would work that in, and you know, people, there was resistance to that because it wasn't the canon. And from my students.
And that was the 80s.
80s, 90s,
2000?
Yeah, even into 2000. Yeah, and then, I don't know, I mean, now women's studies seems to have disappeared into gender studies, and I don't know whatever happened to things like women's history, if that still exists, or, you know, like, there is more attention being paid to some of the women philosophers than there used to be. But I would pull together whatever scraps of information I could find and put them together into... I have a piece on that that's also going to be in my web pretty soon about teaching history of philosophy of that period.